a product designer, okay, Obi Anaduze, who helped build a blood donation app for Live Bank services, has been killed by a stray bullet just moments after tweeting, "Nigeria won't end me." Obi, who was a graduate of computer science from the Federal University of Agriculture, Abeokuta, was shot in his home located on St. Paul Street in Oshodi area of Lagos on Wednesday. Although details are still sketchy, social media reports state that the deceased was killed by a stray bullet from the Makinde police station.
And joining us is Ferdinand Ademefe, creative entrepreneur and social analyst. Thank you so much for joining us, Ferdinand.
Thanks for having me. Good morning.
Morning. The news of Oke's death has been really shocking. Following the reports, you know, across social media all through yesterday, it was about the only picture that, you know, I kept seeing, you know, after, you know, every slide. How much, you know, of a disaster is this once again?
Well, I think this is actually even inciting more violence, because this was what caused the protest in the first place. The demand for injustice, the demand for justice of for the people that were murdered by SARS. And the approach of the federal government has actually been very underwhelming. First of all, there was a 5 for 5 demand where we're insisting on the government doing something about those who were killed, compensating the families. At least we wanted to see open prosecution of those who committed these crimes. We've not seen any of these things. What we are now seeing is even more violence and brutality. I've been very actively involved with the protest, even at the Lekki Toll. And one thing I can say for a fact, if there was ever any peaceful protest, the Lekki Toll embodied that. There are quite a number of people killed at the Lekki Toll. I know we're all trying to gather the names. There are some guys that you might not necessarily find on Twitter, but they have families. And once the curfew is over, we'll do the work we can to get the names of these people. I'm personally committed to that, that we'll definitely identify these people and bring their pictures and bring their families. We'll do that, and I'm open to working with you guys to take you guys to where we can find these people. But what we saw there was still pretty much a government that is disillusioned, disengaged, and downright uninterested in the lives of its citizens. I mean, just we were thinking our voices would count. We did not even know that our lives don't. What the government has shown to us is that our lives don't matter. The president is yet to issue any statement. His legacy of silence has always been something we're used to, but this is now a legacy of blood. And it's a shame, because at some point we had hoped sincerely that this government would symbolize something different. But they are even giving us a foretaste of what could never have happened in Nigeria. This is the worst we've ever seen. The country as it is not working. See a young guy that has been murdered sitting at home. We have, if you've seen the pictures and the videos of the police brutality, they are shooting people at sight, killing people at every part of the country. We don't know what's happening, but we know that the police currently, we're not just looking at reforming the police anymore. We really think there has to be an overhaul in anywhere and every form. These guys have no value for human life. They don't have any value for the human life. And how can you protect people when you don't have an empathy? Right? So we're talking about the process of recruitment. These men were just picked up the streets. I'm not even sure they are qualified enough to understand fundamental human rights. I'm not even sure that they were trained enough to understand what they're supposed to do. The police are as worse as the criminals they try to go after. So guys, it's a painful season. All through yesterday, if I can tell you, I have been really saddened by this. This was not the outcome we had hoped for. And now we're seeing that hoodlums are joining the government, the military, to even further cause mayhem. And you know, but those are not the protesters. We must make it clear. The hoodlums are not part of the protest team. The protest team have always been civilized and well-behaved. But the government have created the environment for the hoodlums to invade society.
Ferdinand, let me interject. You are concerned about the protesters, and a lot of Nigerians are. The reality, though, is that we still have officers on the streets. We have police, we have the army all over the state and across Nigeria. Are you concerned that there might be a repeat of stray bullet killing another innocent Nigerian? And what would you advise protesters and bystanders at this time?
Well, honestly, I think that even when we observe peace, we're seeing that the peace did not even work. I would really advise every protester to be alert. Try and be calm as much as you can, right? In the face of opposition, try if they come to you, even if you have to go on your knees and raise your hands. Even in Lekki here, everybody obeyed, went on their knees and raised their hands. It didn't stop the police. But I think we can't call the police off the street. We don't have the authority to do that. The government has the authority to call the police to order. And quite frankly, that's not happening. We are only seeing speeches and apologies and disclaimers, but not in the way of responsibility and not in the way of tangible action. So we really want to see tangible actions, right? And for every day we wait, things get worse. And that's the fear of this circumstance. Every day we wait, things are getting worse. Even yesterday at the toll, people came out. So the resolve by the Nigerian people to demand for change and for accountability, both for lives and property, is not just something that will pass. We've always wanted to see change. We know Nigeria is rough, and that we are going all the way out to see that we bring about change is what this is about. I would really think that the police at this point in time would have to, you know, I don't know why we don't have things like rubber bullets. Even if you want to go and, you know, anti-protest, can't we use something less harmful, like a rubber bullet or even water in most cases? Why shoot at people? Right, I think that's what we are finding here, that can't we even look at possible ways of even containing violence if you have to, without using guns and bullets to kill people? There are ways and more creative ways and more respectful ways of calming down things than shooting and killing people outrightly. So the Nigerian police is a rot, it's a shame, it's a decay on every level. The Nigerian police is nothing to write home about. And this is part of what we're seeing in what we're demanding for. They've killed more people than have been named. All across Nigeria, families are mourning for loss of loved ones. And the government has still not brought these people to trial. A young product designer has been shot down sitting at home. He wasn't even in the protest ground. And the stray bullet has gone to hit him because these guys have not been fully trained. They don't understand how you can cop crime. They shoot at every... Stray bullets are killing people every day. It is not meant to be. But because we're not demanding accountability, they think it's the way it has to happen.
All right.
And every time we tell you it was a stray bullet, we want to account for Nigerian lives. Even if you kill by a stray bullet, you have to take the fall for it. And we want to see the convictions.
Ferdinand,
we want to see the prosecution.
Hold
the setting up panel and panel of inquiry is always the government's rhetorics.
Yeah, let me quickly step in here. One of the things that became very popular yesterday was a tweet by the person we're speaking about now. A tweet that said, "Nigeria will not end me." A couple of hours later, he was dead. What can you say about the reason a lot of people are losing faith in the country and are looking for ways to take their dreams elsewhere? This is a very, very promising, talented, inspiring young man who has barely even started his life, but of course is gone now. How much does this hurt that there's more of these young, talented, very, very bright futures that have all been gone to waste? I'm sure you also got to see the video of the man who was shot in the streets. I'm not sure what part of Lagos that was, the video that was filmed from a window. That also is somebody who could have had a very, very beautiful future. Yes, that's the video on your screen you can see now. That also is someone that could have had a very, very bright future, but of course it's gone now. What can you say about how the Nigerian government is treating the leaders of tomorrow?
Well, I think that we know from all we have seen that there is really no place for the young person in Nigeria. When you look at the indices, the stats are against the young people. Up until last year, we could not even run for election if you were not 40. You could not run for election if you were not 35. In 1999 constitution that has been scripted to remove the young people from any political process or political governance, how can a 40-year-old man not be able to run? Take an example of that. A 40-year-old man, it's likely to have almost 20 years work experience or 15 years work experience. We're talking about a digital era where countries are competing on the digital space with technology. Our government is still stuck in analog because technology is the language of the young people. I mean, we're born into the world as digital natives or digital immigrants. So we kind of understand and are intuitive with technology. We're talking about it's a country where unemployment is at record high. If we look at cyclical unemployment, which is looking at unemployment at the level of even on gainful employment, we're talking about an unemployment rate that is somewhere around 50-60% if you're looking at on gainful employment and the technically unemployed. So that's the country is not working. If you look at education today, there are more graduates graduating than there are jobs to take them. When you look at the number of Nigerian children who are not in school, we have the highest anywhere in the world. About 13.5 million Nigerian kids are not in education today. And this is the reality. We have the resources to change this country. We have the resources, but we're seeing bad stewardship. So we've seen that the young Nigerian can see through the lens, that there is really a sense where there is a complete lack of accountability. Every day we wake up to stories of corruption. The other day was NDDC, the other day was NNPC, it was the EFCC boss the other day. And these are not just an isolated case. It's a systemic rot that runs through all the parastatal, all the government agencies. So if we're talking about reforming the police, it's just a step in the room, because the immigrations are just as corrupt. Customs are just as corrupt. The military, as we have seen, is even they're killers, and they are just as corrupt. We talk about how the embezzled funds that could have been used for weapons to fight Boko Haram, to even contain the insurgents, has been more a PR war than a reality on ground. The big bring back our girls till date, no answer has been given to that. So everybody seems to have moved on. The government is not making any effort for compensation or even to fight for the lives of the girls who were taken. So what we have seen from the point where we're standing is that this country is completely the racket of a few. People have hijacked this country as a personal project, and the country cannot continue to run this way. Nigerians who are relocating to Canada, many of them are not doing so because they want to, because they know that it's going to be almost suboptimal for them to live in a country where they cannot, where it's a country that is called a human wasteland. This is a human wasteland. It's the wasteland of dreams, and people are constantly losing things. I mean, even if you're running a business, I run a business. I know the day-to-day realities of running a business in Nigeria, all the taxes that are coming at you, and yet there are no basic infrastructure. You have to figure out your power. You have to figure out your light. Access to capital is pretty much expensive. Today, to raise capital from any bank in Nigeria is double digit in almost 29-30% of what you're going to be doing. Access to capital is expensive, right? So if you're young, running business, you don't have capital, you're dealing with all those issues, and you're also dealing with personnel costs. And at the end of the day, you have to retrain significant number of the people you employ, because the quality of education that is producing these people is almost nothing to write them about. So you're going to have cost of retraining and retraining. So at every point in time, you find the system being very, very hostile. And almost very, very, the decay is deep. So we know it's not working. That's why we're on the streets. I mean, we've expanded. It was 5 for 5. And then I was part of the team that pushed for 7 for 7, because we felt the 5 for 5 was a reaction than a solution. And in the 7 for 7, we're saying, let's talk about reforms across the federal, all the parastatals. If we fight for police and go home today, we're likely to come back and fight for customs.
Let's move into...
That's not the point.
Now you've mentioned, of course, the protests and the demands. The last 48 hours, I believe, you know, might have discouraged, you know, some people from being a part of this. You know, so what would your message be to everyone who started the protest? Might, of course, be feeling down emotionally and psychologically. What happens next? We have a 72-hour curfew. What do you think happens next, and what would your message be to them?
To everyone who has been part of this struggle, I want to say, don't lose hope. Keep hope alive. The reality of this is that it wasn't going to be an easy journey. We know that it was going to cost us. We just didn't think it was going to be human lives just at this point, but we know it was going to be expensive. I mean, you don't make demands for change without seeing the hostile resistance from those benefiting from the status quo. So we understand that this will continue, but I would say for us, this is the price we have to pay for the nation we want to live in. This is the price we have to pay for the kids we want to raise to live in this country. So please don't give hope. It's part of the process. After the curfew, we are hitting the streets again. But I also want to urge everyone who is part of the protest that the journey for us is not just about hitting the streets. We need to start getting into closure and make clear our demands again and insist that the government can get to the table. And when they call us for that consultation and negotiation, we are clear about what we want. We have it up on change.org. Read up on the change.org, contribute your own ideas. We're articulating clearly what we want. So guys, let's not lose faith. It's going to cost us, like I said, but ultimately the reward will be there. Our country will be better for it, and people will have a reason to know that indeed change has come. And the political class benefit from when we give up. So they're expecting that we're going to do that. I mean, they're attempting to break us, to break our the Nigerian spirit, to break the fight, but it's not going to work, because we know that it's deeper than any one of us. No matter how many people we lose, we're still going to keep fighting till we see change. Ours is a generation that has to pay for the change we want to see. We're not just going to betray our nation and betray our children. We will stand out there. We will keep going out there. We'll keep making our demands. We'll keep tweeting until the government can listen or till they get out of power. And if we can't do it now, we know 2023 is ahead. And I want to encourage every young person that 2023 gives us an opportunity to do a wide sweep change. That for me, anyone who has served in this government is not worth coming back on any level. It's not worth coming back. But my point is, we cannot make this case if we're not part of a political party. So it's not about joining a new political party. It's about joining any party and being part of how the primaries are done. Many times we wait for them to decide who gets the primary ticket, and we are now left with the bad choices at the general election. But if we have a party card and we're part of the process of change, we realize that we play a role in who emerges at the primary level. And I think that's where this is going. Fight for now, fight for the future, fight for 2020, we fight for 2023, fight for police reforms, we fight for reforms across the federal government. If the curfew is over, we keep coming out, but don't be violent, don't fight, don't use arms, let's keep standing for peace, and wherever we can, let's maintain peace and order. I mean, that's the promise we're making to the Nigerian people and the protesters, or my advice to the protesters as well.
Ferdinand Adimefe, thank you so much for speaking with us, and of course, looking forward to having another conversation with you.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Always. Pretty interesting. One of the things that he mentioned that I you know, thought was important was, you know, the fact that there's no way, the names of the people who have lost their lives, you know, and I was saying it earlier, we just have figures, we don't have names. You know, the Nigerian government hasn't been able to get to a stage where every single life matters, every single soul that is gone, you know, matters and must be recognized, must be named, must be identified. We can't be talking about 20, 21, 18. It has to be, you know, names. And also, okay, it's gone. That talent is gone. Whoever he was meant to be in the future, in the next 20, 30 years, that's gone. Whatever role he was meant to play for Nigeria and for his family and all of that, that's gone. Same thing with a lot of other people. The video where the police officer shot the guy on the ground on his back, one of the stories that we took earlier on the stories, that guy's gone too. Whatever, you know, he was meant to play, whatever role he was meant to play in our future, you know, as a human being, as a person, that's all gone.
Indeed, it's quite sad what we're going through at the moment. But like he said, keep hope alive.
Exactly.
Hopefully, we will get through this and still remain strong.
Absolutely.